Buenas noches. Tonight, we're going to give an introduction to the Flower of Life and to present it in a slightly different way than it is presented in the books. Also to talk about the relationship the Flower of Life has to sacred geometry and to a few other related subjects like crop circles and ETs and a lot of other things associated with it. These two guys on the screen, by the way, are some of the original ETs. They're not from here, really, they're not. They're from the star Sirius. And before that, they were from another galaxy, further back over that. And then one day, when they came to Sirius, they found out that Sirius and our sun were linked and moved together, and they came here. But they're not really from here. Okay, probably most of you have guessed by now, this is the Flower of Life. Flower of Life, it's interesting how I found out about it. It took me 12 years of research, of doing research with sacred geometry. And ultimately, anyone who works in sacred geometry long enough comes back to the realization that this holds all sacred geometry, period and end, everything there is. Now, what is sacred geometry? Well, everything in the reality, everything, the stars, the planets, the sun, your body, everything in this world that we know of, just everything that exists, everything that's manifested, manifested through the sacred geometrical proportions. And there is no exceptions, absolutely zero. Everything you can think of, any words you can say, in fact, the very words themselves came out of sacred geometry. Even language comes out of sacred geometry. It's all of that. Even things that you would never guess, like emotions and feelings. It was Manfred Klein and Dan Winter in the United States who figured out that emotions were related to sacred geometry. They put people on EKG machines and put them up and found that there was a sine wave signature that a person was emitting when they were feeling a certain feeling. And every feeling has a unique sine wave signature. And those sine wave signatures are then converted into three-dimensional forms that you can hold in your hands. And all of those forms are based on sacred geometry. So there's a thing, you can, a three-dimensional polyhedron you can hold in your hand that represents love, and another one that represents the opposite, say hate. And so this is clear with the entire world that's studying this right now, and I'm not the only one. There are a lot of people now studying it. But there was a time, even though this is new to the world right now, it's new because it hasn't been remembered in a long time. There were only a few people. Rudolf Steiner started to remember this, and people like Buckminster Fuller started to understand it, though he only understood it to a certain level. He didn't really fully get it. And then people like Robert Lawler really got it, and Keith Kirchlow definitely got it. And these people started talking about it, but most of the world didn't have any idea what they were talking about. But long ago, 6,000 years ago, all the way up until roughly right after the Greek Empire in ancient Greece, this was known everywhere, all over the world. The Flower of Life was like Elvis Presley. I mean, everybody knew it. And I'm just going to show you a few places just so you can understand that this truly was everywhere, all over the world. There's different things in here. This is called the Flower of Life. There are 19 circles, if you counted them. in here, and they're surrounded by two circles. Those outer two circles are not just for looks. They're extremely important in all of this. And inside the middle of here, there's this middle one where you see these six petals. And then outside of that, there are six more that move around that. If you could see that, it's hard to see, but you'll see it in a minute. That's called the seed of life. And these are not words I'm making up. These are the actual words that were used in ancient times to describe this. I think they called it the flower of life because it looks like a flower and because it is the laws and proportions for everything alive and even not alive, everything that's manifested. So the first thing I'm going to do is just show you places around the world where this was found in ancient times. The Essenes, 500 BC. This was their first city that they built after they came out of Egypt. And in the very center of the of this complex, these are ancient ruins here, this is at Masada, they had a church. And in the center of that church, it was their most important building. And though it's really hard to see in the slide, and if you pull it up close and look at it, you can see it. But right here, this is the floor. And it's not even focused. You got to do, okay, trust me. This was a big square at one time. And squares that came in right here, which you could see the outer ends of it that was still left on the floor, was the flower of life. It's very clear if you're there. I've had people over there and took really good photographs of it. And so the flower of life was actually a central motif in the Essene community. This is comes right out of the center, like I was showing you before. And you'll see both of these, both the center one and that complex right there in ancient times. This is a mosaic floor out of Greece. It's on the island of Crete. And right there, you can see the central motif out of the flower of life. However, the flower of life is found all over Greece. I don't have all the slides here to show it. In fact, they found something that I just got recently, which is really incredible. It's a monastery in Greece. It's very old. It has a big white wall all the way around it, and it's all white buildings, white inside, white outside. And on the outside of this wall, about every 100 feet, is the flower of life all the way around it. And in every single building, in every single room inside, and even windows in stained glass, is the flower of life. It's interesting. The monk who ran that was named Melchizedek. This is off of a very, very old chest that came out of Turkey. And here you can see the flower of life motif with the six circles moving around it. We found it in 18 places around the Mediterranean, in countries practically all the way around it. So it was really well known there. This is called the seed of life, which is out of the middle of the flower of life. And this one here is an interesting one. This is a business that we started a long time ago making organic seeds from 1988. But this pattern in the back is the seed of life. And it was taken from a wooden box that came from Tibet. And the box contained an instrument for planting seeds. But it came from Tibet. This comes out of Ireland. And it's a doorknob. The doorknob went right through there. And this is more complex with all this Gaelic designs and things. But there's a star here and a star coming back. And there's the 13 patterns. And if you've studied the flower of life, you'll know that this is all connected to the flower of life. We found it in England and France. And we found it in Israel and several places. We found it in Egypt. In fact, the first place we ever found it was in Egypt. It was found on a 6,000-year-old wall in Egypt, though I believe that even though the wall was 6,000 years old, that the flower of life was not done 6,000 years before, what was done by the Coptics in 500 BC, about the same time as the Essenes. The Coptics and the Essenes were working together. And here's another man we're all familiar with, Leonardo da Vinci, out of the Italian Renaissance. He definitely knew about the Flower of Life, though the people who have studied Leonardo da Vinci and have spent their lifetime trying to understand his work do not understand this. In fact, it was found in a book of things that they threw away because they didn't know what it was. But this is Leonardo's drawing, showing where he's got the Flower of Life pattern expanded inside of here. And Leonardo spent a great deal of time looking at all the little angles that were inside the Flower of Life, making each possible way and relationship that he could find out of this. And he made pages of these, studying the Flower of Life in great detail. But of course, he was a Mason. And the Masons were intimately connected with the Flower of Life. And that proof is beautiful, though I can't show it to you right here. The Masons, whenever they built a temple, in fact, all the churches that were built in Europe in the earlier days, when they removed the cornerstone out of it, on the back were the signatures of all the Masons and the architects who built that. They were very strange-looking things. They were like a circle with a line going across, or a line like this, and then a line coming over like they were. You just look at them, you go, what's that? But we've looked at several hundred of them, every one that we could find, the names of all these Masons, and every single one of them mapped perfectly over the Flower of Life. So obviously, they also knew about it, and so do all the zodiacal signs that are in astrology, map perfectly over the Flower of Life. And so do the ruins. You know, the ruins, the ones that you throw to get the thing, where they came from. Anybody know? Is Sweden or Norway or somewhere up in there? All the ruins map perfectly over the Flower of Life. So they were using that as their key also. And so I could go on for a long time, actually. I'll go a few more. We mentioned Tibet, but a place where this symbol was extremely popular and is even till today was China. It's all over China even today. If no matter where you go in there, you'll find it constantly. You'll find it on their screens. You'll find it these folding screens. And one of the most prominent places is in the Forbidden Palace. And in the Forbidden Palace, in the emperor's throne, there are two lions, these snarling lions on either side of his throne. And the lion on the left side of him, if he was facing out, was a female, and it just has a kitten, a lion kitten under her paw. But the lion on the right side, the male, has under his right paw a three-dimensional Flower of Life. It's a sphere, but it's three-dimensional. And it says right in front of there, because this was what the emperor said, was that this lion was protecting all the knowledge of the universe. And then, if you go into China, you'll find the Flower of Life everywhere. It's all over the Shinto temples. And again, you'll see the lions protecting not only the Flower of Life, but the seed of life, and even the central core of life will be displayed. And the first time I ever gave one of these workshops in Japan, I had three Shinto priests who knew that I was going to talk about this sat in my class, and they were very quiet. They didn't say hardly anything. And then every once in a while, I would say something, I'd be explaining stuff like that, and they go, they'd visibly be shocked, and finally they warmed up a little bit, and we got to talk, and they said they had been Shinto priests, they had been priests all their life, but they didn't know what it meant, because they had lost the true meaning that was behind all of this. One of them, when I got to something that's called Metatron's Cube, which you're going to see in just a minute, he just about fell out of his chair. Because Metatron's cube, once a year, they put on this beautiful silk white robe, and over the breastplate is this complex pattern called Metatron's cube, which we have up there. None of them knew, had any idea what it was. They didn't even know. All they knew was that from ancient times, they were to wear that thing and walk down the street once a year and do this particular ceremony, but they had no idea what this thing was. And this is what we found everywhere, all over the world. There was a time once when the whole world knew about this, but at this point, almost everybody's forgotten what it is. Even the Freemasons, by the way. I've had very high levels of the Freemasons go through here, and when they study very carefully what's going on, they were not even told about a lot of the things that we're talking about, because more than likely, even their leaders have forgotten. So I don't remember what the next slide is. Aha, I do remember now. this pattern could be infinite. I mean, you could keep right on going and going up across the whole wall. You could keep going forever. But all over the world, they stopped at 19 circles and put these two circles around it. Why did they do that? Why didn't they go out further, or why did they go only in the middle? Why was it always 19 circles? Well, that became clear as I was studying this and we were decoding what this was. The reason is because, and I can't explain this, you're going to have to read into the books in order to understand this, but spirit, when spirit comes out of the void, out of nothing, and begins to do a vortex rotational motion in a certain way, it creates the flower of life. And there's a vortex pattern that it makes that begins to make this pattern. And if you were to complete the circles that are only partially drawn, like here's one here that's only partially drawn, here's another one that's only partially, here's a little piece of one that's, and here's like three pieces of ones that are only partially drawn, you're going to find lots of them in here. They're not completed circles like this one. If you complete all the circles around the outer edge, just do that. And when you do, this yellow is where the two lines of the flower of life was. And these blue ones are the completed flower of life pieces that were missing. You do that. And then the innermost points, which we talk about in the book, are here, there, 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 and there. That's where the next rotational vortex is. And so when you do it, you make the next vortex, you get another sphere at each one of those places, and they link through and form this pattern of 13 circles. In other words, they didn't want you to see this pattern of 13 circles because it was too sacred. In the ancient world, that pattern could not be displayed publicly. They would kill you if you did it. I would be killed for showing you this if this was, you know, 3,000 years ago, because it was too sacred for just the average person to know. So if you extract it out, you get this, leaving out all the rest of it, and you have these 13 circles. This was called the fruit of life to the ancients. And it has 13 systems of knowledge in there. And the reason it's called the fruit, because it fills in all the details of the reality, of this reality we live in, all the tiny established and created through this one single pattern. Now, there are a lot of other things that happen coming to this pattern that we haven't talked about. And that you can pick up in the books if you read them. But I just want to talk about this one pattern for a little bit. In sacred geometry, a straight line is considered male. There's total consensus in the world on this from all people that I'm aware of that are studying in sacred geometry. But any curved line that's not straight, no matter what the curve is, it's female. I mean, you can just look at male and female bodies and see that the male body is straighter and the female body's curvier. But at any rate, in sacred geometry, this has been established. And this image that you're looking up here is all female. There's no male in here. But there's 13 ways that the male can be superimposed over the female. 13 different, entirely unique ways. And each one produces this vast system of knowledge that just keeps expanding out further and further. I mean, you could spend half your life studying each one of these systems of knowledge and never come to the end because it's so complex and there's so much involved in it. In the Flower of Life books, I only show 4 of the systems because it's just too much to go on to all of it. But by looking at 4 systems, you can definitely understand. Tonight, we're only going to look at 1. Because we'd be here the rest of the night just doing this. The simplest, most obvious way to link male lines, straight lines, over the female curved lines is simply by connecting all the centers together, the centers of these circles. In other words, to connect this center to that center, you draw a straight line through there. But this center here would be another line. This center would run that way, up that way. This one would run from here over to there. And you just do all possibilities of every possible way that straight lines can move over there, and you get this. And if you could focus it a little bit. And this is called Metatron's Cube. This is what was on the Shinto's priest, on the breastplate of the Shinto's priest, where the guy practically fell out of his chair when I showed him this, because to them, it was one of the most sacred images in existence. And so you could just say, well, so what? What is it? It's just a bunch of lines, you know? I mean, it doesn't mean anything, does it? Well, it really does. In just regular geometry, not even sacred geometry, but in regular geometry, there are a lot of polyhedron, three-dimensional shapes that connect back into themselves. And there are 5 of them that are unique. They're completely unique. There are no others like them. And they're called the Platonic solids. It was after Plato in the Grecian times when he was talking about the Platonic solids, though he was not the first. And in fact, they have traced the Platonic solids back in humanity scientifically 20,000 years BC, where they have found people alive somewhere that have carved three-dimensional, the 5 Platonic solids three-dimensionally that have been dated back to 20,000 BC. So it's been around a while, at least. But inside of here are those 5 Platonic solids. You can't see them. It takes time. You got to figure it out. But what you do is you keep certain lines and you erase other lines to get to them. For example, if I was to only keep these lines and erase all the other ones, and these little white lines are the ones that are on the back side of this three-dimensional form, and the heavy ones are on the front side of it, you get something called the icosahedron, which is this. And that, of course, goes back around. It's 20 triangles linked. What makes these this one, the icosahedron, and the other 4 unique is that they have these characteristics. All the edges of this shape are all the same, all over. They're all the same length. All of the faces are the same. They're equilateral triangles. All of the angles inside are exactly the same. And this shape will fit inside of a perfect sphere where all the extending points out of here will lie on the surface of the sphere. Believe me, they have taken computers and had these computers run day and night for months and months and months trying to find a 6th platonic solid. No one's ever found one. These are all 5 of them. There's a tetrahedron, a cube, an octahedron, the icosahedron we just looked at, the pentagonal dodecahedron, and the sphere, of course, from which is not one of the platonic solids, but it's where they came from. The sphere is what contains them. Because all the points of these things are sitting on the surface of this sphere invisibly. So the female, which is pure female, gave birth to these five different male forms. They're male because they have nothing but straight lines in them. Understand? So what are the platonic solids? Well, any engineer that goes to college has to learn about these because they are the forms that determine structure. Like if you're building a bridge or anything else like that, you have to know stress and everything else like that. And they're all based back onto these five shapes. Structure is the primary key of them. For example, all crystals known to man, which there are slightly more than 100,000 of them, like quartz or emerald or different kinds of crystals, all have the atoms inside of them arranged in different geometrical patterns that are all functions of these five platonic solids, period, in the end. No matter what the crystal is, it came from one of those five shapes. And viruses, all viruses are polyhedron. They're just shapes like this. That's all they are. And all viruses in existence came from one of these five shapes, which, by the way, is the secret on how you can cure all viruses. We've already done it. They just won't let us talk about it. Somebody will do it. Once you figure that out, it's not too far behind. You can eliminate any virus by knowing how this works. Everything in our reality, in fact, if you want to just jump to the very end period of the whole, bottom line of the whole thing, the periodic table of elements, all the elements of everything from hydrogen to helium to et cetera, all the way through and silver, gold, all the way that the electrons are arranged around the atoms and the way that they are configured inside of there are all a function of one form, which is the cube. That's been established scientifically. Now, they didn't understand it when they did it. All they knew was that that one form determines everything. And so, in other words, the very fabric of all, which is just atomic levels of everything inside of our reality, from every level conceivable on an atomic level, is a function of one of the platonic solids. You can go deeper and deeper and deeper into this, and the more you study it, the more outrageous it is, the more you begin to realize that everything is a function. But this is just the structural pattern. They're important to understand in many different disciplines, but they're also important to understand if you're trying to figure out why you're here and what this reality is all about. And yet, this is only one system out of 13. So there are 12 more extraordinary systems of knowledge, not based on this, that go into other levels of our existence. There's even a system of knowledge that determines consciousness itself. When consciousness, the very levels of where consciousness is harmonic and is able to interpret the one reality that exists. And there is only one reality. There just is whatever there is. But there are many, many, many ways, at least 100,000 ways that Melchizedek have determined that you can interpret that one reality. And all of those are based on sacred geometry. You can actually measure, if you went to a planet that you never saw before and you got some weird looking ET, and you could just lay them out and measure them and figure them all out and find out which one of these forms he came out of, his structural form or anything like that. And you can do certain things to determine, and you can find out exactly, without ever even talking to them, how they're interpreting the one reality, how they're seeing it. The ancients gave names to these five things, these five different forms. This was the tetrahedron was called fire. The cube was called earth. The octahedron was called air. The icosahedron was water. And the pentagonal dodecahedron was ether or prana, life force energy or chi. And these five, the combination of these five forms created a discipline called alchemy, where the understanding of the blending of fire, earth, air, water, and ether were what created everything and were the basis of creation itself. Another basis of creation itself is the DNA molecule. The DNA molecule is what contains the knowledge of, say, how your body is created. However, I believe that it's a little bit further along than that, that it actually contains the knowledge of how to create the entire universe. But it has at least that much of how to create your body. But all the physical forms, biological forms on the earth, are all based on DNA. And that, the DNA molecule, is based only on these two forms. Now, there is a way, the original way was that they saw it as a cube that was rotating at 72-degree angles. That was one of the first ways. And then later, other scientists discovered that, okay, you could see it that way, but a better way is seeing it with these two forms here. These two forms are in sacred geometry are what are called duals of each other. They're duals because if you take the centers of the pentagonal dodecahedron and they and drew lines between them, you get this form. And the other way around, if you take the centers of this one, you get this form. They're duals of each other. In the same way that these two are duals of each other, if you connect the centers of a cube, you get an octahedron. And this one defines the parameters of this one. So these two are duals of each other, and these are duals of each other. This one here is found also in the cube, and in a way that I'll explain in just a moment. So this is your DNA, and what it is the DNA is just the icosahedron creates the dodeca, and then the dodeca creates the icosa again, which creates the dodeca again, which creates the opposite again. And as it does, it begins to turn, and it makes the two strands of the DNA. And a little detail that's interesting that they've discovered just recently in the last couple of years, you know, in all your biological books, you usually see a DNA molecule sort of coming from nowhere and going nowhere. They just sort of start and twist and stops and like it goes on forever. That's not true. They've thrown that out in the last couple of years, and it's been proven by other universities, though it's not in the textbooks yet, unless you got a brand new textbook. But the DNA molecule wraps back on itself and completes itself, and you can see how it does it because one end is this and one end is that, and they lock, like a little lock, and they form a circle. And what it really is what's called a torus or a toroidal field. It's like a donut. It wraps back around. And the torus or the donut shape is the most unique shape in existence. It can do things that no other shape in existence can do, and it's the first shape that comes out of the flower of life. We didn't talk about all of that, but it is the most primal shape in existence. And so that's what these two things do, is create that. This is very interesting because this is water, and that's prana. Water and life force energy is the pattern that creates the DNA. You could think about that for a few weeks. Just alone, at least I did. Okay. Now, with that basic understanding, we're going to come back here again to Metatron's cube, you know, where we started, where all those different shapes were. And there's one particular shape in here, which is the tetrahedron. But interesting is that when you get the tetrahedron, you don't get the tetrahedron by itself. You get two of them, and they're interlocked in this way. It's called a star tetrahedron. So if you were to take this line And keep that one, and keep this one. Keep the ones that go into the middle. Keep this one here that forms another triangle there. Keep another one that comes down, forms another triangle there. There's a series of them. You'll see them in a minute. Erase all the rest of them. You get this. And at first glance, it doesn't look like anything. Definitely doesn't look like anything three-dimensional. But if you were to shade it in a certain kind of way, it becomes clear. And what that is called a star tetrahedron. And it's also inscribed inside of a sphere. This will fit perfectly inside of a sphere. Star tetrahedron inside of a sphere is one of the most primal shapes and important shapes that I could possibly give to you up here. It's more important even than the DNA. And I'm just going to follow down that one road. I mean, and every one of these shapes relative to sacred geometry, you could spend at least a week just going on and on and on about all the different ways that it goes into the reality on every single one of them. And I don't have that kind of time, so I'm only going to go just a little bit here. But now this blue one goes back out the other way, forming a three-dimensional pyramid going out the other way, out the back end. Okay, what is this? What does it mean? Well, one of the ways that the star tetrahedron inscribed in the sphere is important to life, one of them that we're going to talk about right now, is that it is the basis of all biological life forms. All of them, without exception. I don't care if you're on this planet or if you're in anywhere else and you're some ET and you look pretty strange and weird, you still are going to go through the same things I'm about to talk about. Because there's only one God, there's only one sacred geometry, there's only one reality, and it's all the same no matter where you go. That's the purpose of why we're doing this, because we are interpreting the one reality from an instrument that is polarized, our brain. It's got a left and a right side, and it sees everything as either good or bad. And once the brain sees absolutely for certain that there is only one function, one thought moving through everything, it does this funny thing to the court, what's called corpus callosum, that links the left and the right side together. It begins to open up, and the two sides begin to balance, and enlightenment begins. Enlightenment means moving out of duality consciousness into unity consciousness, where you begin to see the unity of all life everywhere. Begin to realize that every one of us are linked in ways that the world right now has forgotten. And so, let's look at conception. Conception begins with a round sphere, the first one at the top of that pattern we showed before, the pure female energy of the round sphere called an ovum. We all began as a sphere, each one of us. Probably don't remember, but we did. And then through something called mitosis, we divided from one sphere into two. And this is an electron microscope photograph of the real thing, where we divided from one to two. Then when we go from two to four, using the binary sequence, it goes 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, which is one of the sequences of life. There's another really important one called the Fibonacci sequence, which we'll just lightly touch on later. It goes from 2 to 4, but when it goes to 4, it isn't just any 4, any old way. It isn't just 4 cells kind of floating around in a fluid. This is an actual photograph. Forget this one because it's beginning to go to the next level. But there's one here, one here, one here, and back here you can see the fourth one, same size. And if you drew a line between there and there and there and then over to this one in the back, you get a tetrahedron. And it looks like this. The four cells are like that, and they're aligned down the north and south axis. There is a north pole and a south pole to the mitosis division of the ovum. And it forms this pattern right here. But then when it goes from 4 to 8, it forms another star tetrahedron facing this way. Like this, there's one linked in coming down here and one linked in going up there. And it's a star tetrahedron inscribed in a sphere. One of the most important images that there you can ever imagine. And yet we're only beginning to touch on what this really means. It's not just all life that we know. It's even more than that, as you'll see in a little bit. And so, and then to describe the rest of it very quickly, it moves from there. This is also a cube. You'd never know it by looking at that. But if you were to connect the centers of all those together, the star tetrahedron forms a perfect cube also. So the star tetrahedron fits inside another platonic solid called a cube, and it's connected to it. It's the diagonal lines across the cube that form the relationships of this pattern. And just to give you an idea of how intelligent God is, how amazing the Creator is. This here, go back to this other one. Even though this is a star tetrahedron, you're now looking at it from the top, looking down. There is this place where it becomes a cube, and if you were to look at just these four here, there's these other four behind it. So if you were looking from over here at this face, you'd only see these four, and you wouldn't see the four behind it because they would be slightly smaller. And you would get this image here. You'd see these four spheres right here, and you couldn't see the four behind it because they're slightly smaller. And it fits inside of, like we already showed, a perfect cube right here. And that's a cube if it was going back through there like that. And this circle here will exactly enclose those 8 cells. And this other one outside of it is the thickness of the membrane, which is called the zona pellucida of the mitosis at 8 cell division. That is actually determined by the flower of life, where those two lines that are on the outside has actually determined the thickness of the membrane. Even the thickness of the membrane is not an accident. It's not just a random thing. It's all based on sacred geometry. And here you can see the star tetrahedron also inscribed in the sphere at the same time. And we'll explain that in just a moment. And so here Leonardo is actually showing how this relationship of the corners, the width of the circles, and all the relationship of this male form that's in here. But if you think about this for a moment, it's because here is the 8-cell division, and it is in the exact proportions of the real thing. But it also, so that's at one time you were in that shape of 8 cells with this cube around it and the sphere that contained it. And even at the moment of 8 cells, it contains the exact proportions of the adult human body. It's amazing, really. So we just touched upon how sacred geometry works on microscopic levels. What about the macrocosm instead of the microcosm? Let's look up into the macrocosm of the stars and the planets and these kinds of things. There was a man named Kepler. I can't remember when he lived. I think it was 200 or 300 years ago. But I don't actually remember when he lived. But, yeah, you can look it up. And he believed that the positioning of the orbits of our planets in our solar system were not at random, that from everything that he had studied, that they had to be directly connected to the five platonic solids. And he searched for it, he made all these models, and he went through a lot of his life trying to find this, and it wasn't accurate and it didn't work. The reason it didn't work is because his information was inaccurate. They didn't know where the planets were in orbits. And so he was working with inaccurate information. But there are people now, today, who have put this into computers, where they have taken all of sacred geometry that's known and all what NASA knows about where the planets are located relative to the sun. And they know the precise maximum, minimum, and mean orbit of each one of these different planets very precisely. And that was all thrown into the equation. And then a button was pushed to find out what the computer could find. And what they found proved conclusively that it's true. That all of the planets, their orbits, their relationships to each other, you can pick Mars to Earth or Mars to Jupiter, and those relationships are not only are all of them in relationship to the sun, but to each other they are in relationship. And even the sizes of them are not at random. Planets can only be at certain sizes. Sounds outrageous? Well, let's look at this next slide. Oh, not that next slide. I forgot about that one. And I forgot about that one. This one. Again, we have Leonardo's drawing. And first thing I want you to notice is that if you take this body that he's got drawing here with his arms out like that and his legs straight down, so you're like this, there's a perfect square that fits around your body. In other words, you are the height. Now, if you take an individual, that won't be true. There'll be variances. But science has taken large groups. You have to have a minimum of 100 people, and they've measured them really carefully. And they found that the height of the body and the width of the body, there's a difference of only 1/10,000 of an inch. You can barely see 1/10,000 of an inch. And that 1/10,000 of an inch isn't a mistake. It's related to the Fibonacci sequence, which is another subject. I can't tell you about that, but it's not a mistake. It's part of the equation. And so, basically, you are the same height as you are with your arms out. And a cube passes, or a square or a cube passes around there, and the center of that square is precisely at the perineum, the body. If you put your arms like this and your legs out like that, there's a circle that will pass perfectly around there, or a sphere. And it's this one here, which isn't drawn very well. It kind of disappears there. It comes right underneath the feet and goes on around. Comes up here. Comes on down around, comes back down under the feet. And the center of that one is exactly at the navel. And so you have this circle and this square relationship around the human body. Every biological form has different, it chooses different geometrical patterns to structure itself through. And so you have to figure out which one it is, but the human body is the square. And if you then move this circle that's at the navel, and you just bring the whole thing down to the same center as the square, then you get the circle here. And you see how it cuts that corner, just that little bit right there, and it cuts it right there, and right there, and right there. And interesting enough, if you were to measure this square that fits around the body there, the perimeter of that, and then you were to measure the circumference of that, if you have a perfectly formed body, they're the same. And it's been determined, and if you study, you'll see, that when the square and the circle, in China they talk about squaring the circle and circling the square, when the perimeter of the square and the circumference of the circle are the same, that's when human consciousness focuses in, and that's when life begins. And now one step further, if you were this square that goes around the human body, if you put a circle inside of that square, which is this blue in here, and then up here at this circle, you were to come down here and draw a circle around with that, with this to here being your measuring stick, you get this little orange one up here. Guess what? This, relative to this, is exactly mathematically proportionate to the size of the Earth to the size of the Moon. This was determined at least 2,000 years ago. What does it mean? I mean, you know, what does it mean that in the proportions of the human body, the very planet that we're standing on and the Moon that circles around it, it's in there, in the very proportions, predetermined. Is it just a coincidence or an accident? I don't think so. In fact, we know for sure because of what I'm about to show you in a minute. I just mentioned about Kepler and him extending this idea out to, because he knew about this idea also. He knew that the Earth and the Moon were in proportion. That's why he believed that everything had to be in the solar system. I believe it's absolutely everything to the most distant galaxy and the sizes of every galaxy, etc., and everything, but we can prove it in our own solar system. There's a book written. The guy took all of the relationships that the computer found and put them into a book. It's about, I don't know, an inch thick, and it's a couple hundred different possible relationships that you could ever think of. We're going to show one to Chiron and I think Mars. I can't remember how to wait till I get on there. I just chose three of them. But there are about 200 of them that they've picked out, and it's called the Book of Coincidences. And so we were going to, I had got it all together, I got the money together and everything else, and we were going to make a movie about this, a documentary, to show how this was, because this man figured it out. He came over here and then realized, oh my gosh, I'm going to be famous. And he didn't want to be famous, and so he wouldn't allow the movie, and he won't allow anyone to even use his name. So I can't tell you who did it. So I guess it doesn't really matter. But there's only 1,000 copies of the book in the world. And this is one of the pages. I forgot this one too. I just did this last night for the first time. One more thing I got to show you first. If you take the edge of the Earth over to the edge of the Earth, the diameter of the Earth, and from the center of the Earth to the center of the Moon, and then you draw these lines right here, this angle right here is 51 degrees, 51 minutes, 24 seconds, and which happens to be the exact angle and precise proportions of the Great Pyramid. This is interesting because Hermes, who most people who've studied this believe was also a man named Thoth, in the Emerald Tablets that was written by Hermes, he states how the Great Pyramid was built from the proportions of the Earth. Well, whether or not Thoth or Hermes actually built the Great Pyramid, we can't prove that, but we can prove that what he's just said inside that statement is fact. That is, that angle right there is 51 degrees, 51 minutes, 24 seconds. And so this is a precise arrangement of what we just talked about. Now I can go to this other thing that we're going to talk about. This is one of his pages out of this book, and it's the relationship between Chiron and Pluto. And in other words, this is the orbit of these two bodies. This is Pluto here. And these are a very simple relationship. All you have to do and the Sun is in the center. All you have to do is draw a five-sided pentagon, and then you draw one down facing the other way, then you draw one up, and then you draw one down, and you draw one up, And on the inner one, you draw a circle. And on the outer one, you draw a circle. And those lines go up and form the exact relationship between the Sun, Chiron, and Pluto. It's 99.8% perfect, considering we have a moving system through space and time. Everything's moving through there. They're not only going around this way, but the whole thing is moving like this, as a solid body, moving around the galaxy connected to the star Sirius. It's pretty amazing that a simple drawing like this could do that. But when you start looking at first one, then two, then 50, then 100, then 150, these relationships, and they're all that way, anything you can think of, any relationship between, say, the Earth and Mars and the Earth and Venus, the Earth and Mercury, or anything like that, it's already been worked out. They're all there, every single doggone one of them. This is another simple one here. This is the relationship of Earth to Mars. Earth and Mars. Really simple. Just draw a five-pointed star down and one pointed up. The inner circle goes up and is the orbit of Mars relative to the Sun. Of the Earth. And the outer one becomes the orbit of Mars. And it also is 99.8% perfect. They're all 99.8 or 99.9. I think there's one that's 99.7. The fact that could happen is not a coincidence, even though it's called a book of coincidences. Everything. And so, what this is saying is that everything's predetermined. And that's what sacred geometry shows clearly. But there's only certain places where things can happen. And you can see where they're going to be by the geometrical proportions of things. It's possible for the human mind to understand the entire universe on a physical level. You could grok the whole thing with just a little bit of study. And that does this funny thing to the left and the right side of your brain. It's the beginning. It's not the end. It's not what it's all about. It's only the first step. Now, this one's a really interesting one. I chose it for this reason. All over the ancient world, they built temples to try to determine basically the tropic of Cancer and the tropic of Capricorn, the maximum winter dropping of the sun to the maximum. You had the summer. What is that? It's the winter, spring. The difference in this. It's winter, spring, I think. But it's when the sun swings one way down and swings down the other way, and you try to determine those points. You need to know the equinoxes so you can do your planting and all these things like this. They could have simply drawn this drawing in the sand, one pentagon down, one up, one down, one up. It's just four of them. One was five, one was two, and one was four. And drawn the circles inside there like that, drew them down into a ring, and if you could put them over a sphere, those rings, as they fit over a sphere, precisely locate the Tropic of Cancer, the equator, and the Tropic of Capricorn. That is 100% perfect. It is absolutely right on. Now, this whole thing about a star tetrahedron inscribed in a sphere has come about it in a slightly different way. We were showing how it is the basis of all biological life forms, and how in the microcosm, and how the relationships of those of the five atomic solids are out in space around us. This is a crop circle, and it was one that Richard Hoagland was analyzing. I became at one point. Richard Hoagland was the person who found, using NASA photographs, the face on Mars. And that face on Mars has been discredited by NASA like crazy. But if you knew the truth of why they were doing that, you'd understand. They don't want you to look at Mars because there's too much going on there right now. and they don't even—they really got angry at him for even bringing our attention to the planet at all, and they really tried to blow him out of the water. But he proved beyond a doubt what he was talking about. But still, they're not going to agree with him on any level, even though it's what he talked about is fact. But there, around the face of Mars, were many other actual pyramids. Lots of them, 3-, 4-, and 5-sided pyramids, and there's I don't know how many there are, but there's about 25 or 30 of them out there on the desert. One of them is called the D and M pyramid, and that pyramid is extraordinary. If by its mere size, it's a 5-sided pyramid, but it's 10 miles high, 50,000 feet plus high. And when they laid out all that pattern over the whole thing and all the relationships of pyramids, and they drew all the lines between them, all the sacred proportions and all the sacred geometrical relationships became apparent. But when they analyzed the DNA pyramid and in relationship to everything, it came up with this funny shape that they didn't understand. It kept talking very powerfully about a star tetrahedron inscribed in a sphere. And so he didn't know what the heck it meant. All he knew was whoever was on there and who, at some time, whoever lived there, was definitely trying to say how important the star tetrahedron inscribed in a sphere was. So he knew. He found out I was doing this work and he called me and we started talking about it. And I told him what it was. And I told him that it not only is it the basis of all life and everything and all structure and everything else like that, but it's also actually exists around the human body three-dimensionally in an electromagnetic field that sits at about 4 degrees Kelvin. That's about 4 degrees above absolute zero. And that you can actually put it on a computer screen and see it if you have the right instruments and everything. And that very intricate pattern, which is inside of the which is in the book, which we don't have it all in the book, but most of it. It also is inside of all the planets, and it's also inside the sun, exactly the same, and the galaxy, etc. And it's also around atoms and everything else. It's around everything. It's always the same. Even if it's a little daisy growing out in the field, the patterns around it are the same. They're just smaller. They're in proportion to it. And so he started thinking about all of that, and when he got to this particular crop circle, one of the mathematicians that was working for him, this is that crop circle drawn very, very precisely, they found these particular angles, etc. And when at first look at this thing, you go, what does it mean? It doesn't mean a darn thing to me. Well, he has very high-powered mathematicians that work with NASA and work also with him that spend a lot of time with their computers trying to figure out what this meant. And they all got done. They said, gee, I don't understand it, but what it's describing is a three-dimensional star tetrahedron inscribed in a sphere. And he goes, no. And this began an even deeper looking into what this was all about. Well, here's the same drawing we've seen a little while ago. And around the human body is the star tetrahedron inscribed in the sphere, exactly in these proportions. The distance from the top of the head to that point is exactly one hand length. And the distance between the feet and the bottom down there is exactly one hand length, your hand length. You're your own measuring stick. And there is a tube that runs from that point all the way through the body, entering in at the perineum, running all the way through, coming out the top of the head, which the Hindus call the crown chakra, and goes up to this one here, where there's another chakra. All the chakras inside the human body that are in the spinal column aspect of it are inside of this tube. We've been able to scientifically document that. And there's not 7 of them, but there's 12 of them. And from the base of the spine to the top of the head, there's exactly 12, and that's the 13th one. Again, those 13 circles that all this began from. This is not outrageous, considering that that's how it all started. When you were a little tiny eight-cell division, you were a star tetrahedron inscribed in a sphere. And you have a sphere of energy around your body that's actually there. It's electromagnetic in nature, and this pattern is really there. And this tube is really there. The Tibetans have known this for a long time. They were the only people left in the world that I'm aware of that truly understand what this is and what it's related to. Under certain conditions, if you breathe in a certain way, and you do something with your mind, and you do something with, actually you're doing something, originally I thought it was the mind and the heart, but I've got that real clear in my mind now. It's really just, you do something with your left brain, and you do something with your right brain, which has to do with your emotional body, and you spin these things. This one can spin like on an axis, the entire thing. There's not one of them there, but there's three that are exactly the same, and one set can move one way, and one set can move the other way. One set remains fixed as the reference point, which is the body itself. Then a funny thing happens. A disc comes out from this point that's about 55 to 60 feet in diameter, and a form takes a shape that looks like a flying saucer. And that form was well known in the ancient world. Just as the flower of life was well known in the ancient world, so was this form, which was called in Israel, in Hebrew, it was called the Merkava, and in Egypt it was called the Merkaba, and in Zulu, in Africa, it's called the Merkaba. And there were places around the world that gave it the same name, the same sound, and it was called a vehicle, the vehicle of ascension or resurrection, either one. They're connected to both of them. And it was, in fact, in Egypt, mer means light, and it means a certain kind of rotating light, and ka means spirit, and ba means body. And so what in Egypt, it was clear, we have traced this one down deeply, mer ka ba means a light field that will take spirit and body from one world to another. It was the basis of everything that the Egyptians were doing. But the Hebrews equally knew what this was about. The word Merkava in Hebrew has two meanings, at least that I've been told. The first one means that it's the throne of God, and the second one means a vehicle or a chariot. It actually means chariot or a vehicle. And so ultimately we chose to go down that direction and to expand upon that, because we are at a time when it is essential that we remember who we are and why we're here, because we are in the end times. And it's, you know, it's fun to go out and do all kinds of things in this world and everything else, but this is the time really to focus on spiritual matters and to really remember why we're here and what this is about. It's essential that some of us do this. Otherwise, this planet will be lost. And so, the shape of the Merkaba and what that is about, I want to talk about also. But I want to go into what Richard Hoagland further discovered about this star tetrahedron inscribed in the sphere, and leave talking about the Merkaba for a moment. Richard Hoagland, through that crop circle and other crop circles that he found, which I'll go back into in just a little bit here. I literally threw these things together when I came here, and I don't really remember the order real well. But Richard was trying to solve a problem of why this was so important. And one of the things that science has found rotating fields associated with it, and all of the shapes and forms that are around the human body have toroidal fields. They're like donuts that are connected to it. And these toroidal fields are so close together, they're like skins of in an onion skin. Those toroidal fields are really important when we talk about the heart in a little while, because there's something really incredible associated with the heart in conjunction with the Merkaba. This is the one I was talking about that Richard Hoagland went crazy over, because you see that everything, this is tetrahedral geometry that they're talking about here. But this line is straight, that line is straight, but this line has a little tiny bend in it right there. And at the time that that was done, there was only about three people in the world that understood that. That is talking about the relationship of tetrahedral geometry and to hyperdimensional space. That's what became the idea that perhaps what they were referring to in the outer planets was hyperdimensional space. Is this particular, this was a crop circle, initially. This is hard to find because of the shot that we took of it. But this is a photograph, an actual photograph, of a galaxy. Not ours, of course. We can't photograph ourselves like that. We'd have to run way out in space and come back in. But this is another one. And if you can see it perfectly, and you can't, there's a sphere of energy here. And then there's a disk that goes around here. And I've got one of an infrared photograph, which I didn't bring. It shows the flying saucer shape perfectly of this. This is called a that galaxy. You are looking at right here the exact size and proportion of the human Merkaba field. It is exact. Only that's in nature that you're looking at. But if you breathe a certain way and you do a certain thing, there's an energy field that can come up on a computer screen about the equipment, and it'll look just like that around your body. That's the beginning of enlightenment, of moving out of polarity consciousness and moving into unity consciousness. It's only the first step. It's not the end. There's many, many steps beyond it, but it's a real important step, because once you begin the Merkaba, your life will never be the same. That's another subject. Life then goes, oh, you're Merkabas, huh? And it grabs you and changes your whole life around and throws you on the ground a few times and changes everything. There's just not much you can do about it after that. It just all starts altering. Spiritually, you begin to move very fast after that. It's not the end. And a lot of people thought this. A lot of people who went out and read and thought, well, all you got to do is just do the Merkaba and that's it. It's not it. There's a lot more than what was in those books. We thought that you would be able to get this from your own guidance. But unfortunately, and I've done surveys on it, only about 15% of the people can actually do that, and about 85% just got lost. And so we have another workshop called the Earth Sky to bring people up to understand another level of what is this. Now there's another workshop called Living in the Heart, which is an extension of the Merkaba workshop. And we're going to give one here in Guadalajara, but I'm sorry, it is book solid. Thank you. I forget to drink. Guess what this is? Very few people have ever seen this photograph. They've seen the books and things. The kings of England. You think about spaceships and things like this coming down in shape. The kings of England, the ancient kings of England, made themselves in these mounds, in the precise shape of the galaxy, but also not only the galaxy, but these guys. Wonder why the ETs chose that shape. Why that shape? Could have been a shape. But that shape is the one that is tied to nature, and it's also tied to Merkaba. The people that are creating these solid ships that have metal in them are of a very low consciousness. They're beginners, and they're still understanding what the is about. They can do a lot, they can go a lot of places, and there's a lot of them out there. They're like fifth graders or sixth graders. They're just beginning the whole process. The ones that are really advanced don't have solid ships. Their ships are made out of light. And your country, Mexico, has been visited for about the last almost 20 years, 20, 21, 22 years now, but intensely the last few years by one of these races. Their ships look like this one. This is from here in Mexico. You're looking underneath it. That's a big thing. That's like about 2 or 3 football fields across. And you're looking under it. That's the bottom. There's 8 of these dark spots in there. And there's this thing here. And it's a field of light. And when these photos were first brought into Germany, have them analyzed, they did 2 things. They realized that they were real photographs. They could prove that. This is before some of these photographs go back over 20-something years, before digital photographs, computers, or any of that stuff. And because of certain things that they did in those photographs, they proved that they were real. But when they put one of these where it was underneath it, so you're looking right underneath it, and that's all you see. It was only like up when they took the photograph. And they put it into the computers in Germany, and the size of whatever it was couldn't be determined. There's no way for the computer to determine how big it was, because in the references against. But what the computer came up with was that it was a human cell. It was alive. It was like a human cell. That's the only thing it could identify it as. And these are called the plasma ships. And how many people here have seen? Anybody? You got a couple, 3, 4 people. You're seeing them, 5, 6, 8, 9. There's 9 or 10 people that have actually seen them. I've talked to quite a few people that have seen them and have photographed them. Carlos Diaz is one of the people that has been seeing them for 20 years. And he has 1,800 photographs and 200 hours of these things. They've only appeared in Mexico and anywhere else. When they first started coming out of the Earth, and they're not ETs, extraterrestrial. They don't come from space. They come from inside the Earth. They're connected to us directly. And they're not weird ones like the grays and the reptiles and all this kind of stuff. There are people who really love us and care about us and are concerned about what we're doing because they're part of the same we're on. And they're little people. They're only about this high. And they're made out of light. I've got videos of them walking right through there. And their ships, when they get on the ship gets bigger. When they get off, it gets littler. And we've got videos of them when they go up in the sky. They might break two and go into 2 different directions, and then maybe another one will break, and they might come back together again. But for a long time, they were only here, and they were seen in a very specific place in the beginning. Now it's changed. In the beginning, I was in giving a workshop, a lecture to an audience. And there were 6 Mexicans that came up. They weren't related to each other or knew that they were coming up together. And they all had footage of these ships that they took themselves and personally saw. And they all saw them in the same place, which was they saw them coming out of the volcano south of Mexico City. Popo, I don't know the whole thing, but Popo. How do you say it? Okay. Anyway, out of, say, Popo. They were coming out of Popo before Popo was active. And they were going up onto the rim, watching in and out about every hour. Coming right through solid rock, going out through there. And some of these people have said it 100 times, going in and out. They would bring people up, watch them go in and out. These are not little; these are huge things. And but in our research, we couldn't find anywhere else in the world where they were coming out. until recently, and now they're starting to come out in the United States also. And and I'm talking to people who had no idea what the phenomena was. I talked to these three young guys, and who had seen them come. They were just sitting on the rim of just a big open mountain range near Colorado, and they were just sitting there, and you know, there's nothing there. No other people were there anywhere, and one of these things came out, and they just about pooped in their pants. And this thing went up in the air and flew around and all this stuff and went back down in the earth. And they actually saw it happen three different times. When they would tell me in front of me, they were so excited that they were all talking at once. And they were going, it's this big, and they were going on and on and on and on. And I was just trying to calm them down long enough to be able to, so they could talk about it. And I've also talked to this 85-year-old lady out in the woods also. And one of these things just came out of the ground in the United States. One I know of, but in this area near Popo, there has been a lot. It's not just a little bit, it's been massive evidence of that. Stephen Greer, who's doing the Disclosure Project. How many people know about the Disclosure Project? Just to get an idea. Nobody? Wow. A few. Yeah, maybe two or three or four. The Disclosure Project is an amazing thing in the United States, and I guess we can talk about it for a moment. But Stephen Greer brought 100 people to there and watched one of these things land right in front of them, watched them fly over the sky, and had videos and all kinds of stuff of it. But he was from the United States. Stephen Greer is Dr. Stephen Greer, and he got approximately 500 government officials from the CIA, FBI, NASA, all different levels of the government, step forward as a unit, as one, and each one had proof that ETs were real. They had all kinds of physical evidence, they had videos. These are the most credible people in the United States government, and they all at one time said, well, they went live in the newspaper, and the newspaper would not, the news media wouldn't even look at it, they wouldn't even talk about it. But they all the evidence, they showed it all, and they said, you know, that's all they could do. But our government has refused to acknowledge that the ETs are here. Now, I spent time in Russia at the before the National Academy of Sciences from Moscow, and they believe they're here. They've got so much evidence on it, it's outrageous. And I did something recently. And I'm amazed I'm still alive for doing this. I did it anyway. There was a man named Edward Ruppelt, Captain Edward Ruppelt, and he wasn't just an ordinary guy. He was the head of the Blue Book Project for the U.S. Air Force, which was investigating UFOs in the very beginning. The very beginning was on a single day, June of 1947, I think it was. Really, that was the date. Spaceships started appearing all over the military bases in the United States. The year before, on June of 1946, they started appearing all over the military bases in Europe. None of them anywhere else. Then they started appearing all over the military bases and things in Japan. This man was the head of the project that brought in all the stuff to see what was there. And they had... I mean, he's the most credible person, at least in the United States, alive. And he had this project for 5 years. He was even the head of the Grudge Project, which was a secret project before the Blue Book Project that was also secretly studying them, but he knew about. And there was one before that called Project Sign, and when Project Sign was turned over to Project Grudge, he was evidence and everything. So he had all the evidence the United States Air Force has ever had from the beginning of 1947 to, I think it was about 1952, and then he got out. And when he got out, he wrote a book called The Report on Unidentified Flying Objects. He was the person that made up the term UFO. And he wrote a book on it, describing everything that they had found. he was in public, out of military, when he was just a normal citizen. He did it a year later, and he wrote all of this. He put all the things, he put all the names of the colonels and generals and all involved, and what they saw and what they found, and it sounds like somebody had just written it this year, the kinds of things that they found. They had 46 sightings in those 5 years, approximately. And of those, they chose 750 of these sightings, which were so credible that it was, they were over military bases. They had ranking military officers on the ground watching the UFO go at close range with an F-94. I forgot what the planes were. F-90. There was jets that they were using, F-94 something, that was behind it. And so the pilot was in the plane looking at the UFO, flying at extreme high speeds right behind it. People were watching the two go over, and the radar was watching the two blimp on over the top of that, on these 750 ones that they looked. And when they tested when they did the investigation on those, they came up with the final result after 5 years of testing is that whoever's doing this is not from here. There is no technology in 1952, they saw these ships. They were describing the UFOs in front of them, and when they would lock on with the ship, would disappear, literally vanish, and reappear either 10 miles in front of them, so they're completely out of range, or directly behind them. And then when they would be out in front of them, let them catch up, so they could look at them. They locked on radar, they disappear and reappear somewhere else. They watched them travel at over 60,000 miles an hour. You think we had anything in 1952 that'd fly 60,000 miles an hour? Not likely. They watched them, they tracked jets as they were following them, going up and up and up and up and up. The jets couldn't fly any higher. And they watched these things just keep going and disappear. And it wasn't just a few. They had 46,000 of them, and they had 750 that they were looking at very, very, very carefully. And so what happened right after he published this, for some reason, he died at 35 years old. And the book became popular for a little while, and then it disappeared. It hasn't been in print for 46 years. I just reprinted it. It's only in English right now. Or the Flower of Life is in 15 languages, so we'll get this out in 15 languages. But if you want it, you can go to my website, drunvalo.net, and you can get it from there. It's only $14.95. In fact, you can go on to thespirit.com. It's www.spirit, S-P-I-R-I-T, O-F. MAAT.com, and we have the whole book on the internet for free. No, it's in English. If anybody translate it into Spanish, we'll put it on Spanish. You know, we want to do it. But absolute proof that they're here. But there's a lot of reasons why they don't want us to know about this. And I don't know if they're ever going to try this for sure. But what's going on here in your country is of major importance. See these guys, don't worry about it. There's nothing to fear. They are pure beings. They're not going to do anything to hurt you. There's one thing I'm going to say about them. You should go take a break. When Carlos Diaz was sitting at the table with Carlos Diaz, who's been on board these ships, and I was talking to him, he said that they told him that they see on the surface of the earth a long, long time ago. I don't know how long that was, a long time ago, at least a million years or more ago. They walked around on earth in some kind of form, and they had a technology, according to them, that was similar to ours, but different, but similar. And they also had no wisdom, and they were killing the planet. And they said an ET race came out of the heavens and landed and came up to them. All they did was tell them something about themselves, something they didn't know. And then they disappeared. And then they said it took about 100 years or so that they figured it out, what they were talking about, and they became pure light, at which point they chose to go into the earth, because there's dimensional levels in the earth, and they live in these dimensional sacks, only sacks inside the earth. That's what they say they want to do with us, is they just want to get our attention on a planetary level, and they just want to tell us something. They don't want to interfere. They don't want to do anything. They just want to tell us something about ourselves and then leave. And they figure that once we know this one thing, we will be able to solve our problems. And I think I know what that message is, and I'll tell you when we get back from the break. Okay, so we'll have a break for about 20 minutes or so, and then we'll come back, and then the second half of this is not going to be real long, because I'm only going to tell you this one. Okay, thanks you guys. Few more seconds. Okay, here we go. While I was learning and understanding this information, which began in 1971, basically from 1971 until about roughly 1996 or 1997, somewhere around in there, I had an experience long about that time that I couldn't understand. I was meditating in my Merkaba, and I was spending a long time meditating in the Merkaba, an hour or more, and everything was sort of normal, when suddenly my body appeared inside of a cave, and it was a rather small cave. It was probably only as big as just this little side over here, and it was really real. It was just as real as this, and I couldn't figure out, you know, I was having the experience, and then it went away after a while, and then it happened again, and then again. And then it kept happening. I kept going back to this same place. And I had no idea what this was. As this began to happen, I had a friend, Pete Carroll, who was the head coach for a football team, the New York Jets. And he kept wanting me to get in contact with this woman. He said, you got to meet this lady. She's very unusual. And I kept going, well, yeah, but I'm really busy. I don't have time to do this. And so I kept putting him off and putting him off because I was so busy. Finally, after a few months, he says, look, you've got to do this. And so he says, I'm going to take your phone number and give it to her so she can call you. And I said, okay. And she called me, and her name was Marianne Shinfield. This woman was an anomaly. She was very, very unusual. She was completely blind, but she could see. She had no eyes, but she could watch television and read books. She could walk around, down the steps, do anything. You would never know in a million years that she was blind. And I started talking to her, and she was not only unusual in that way, but she was unusual in lots of other ways because she was able to see not only the outer world, but she could see psychically in ways that were extraordinary. She told me how NASA found out that she was blind but could see, and so they asked to do experiments with her. And I wouldn't have done it. I would have said, nope, sorry. But she did, and basically now she belongs to NASA. They're with her all the time and constantly doing experiments. But one of them was when, in the very beginning, they asked her, okay, well, you can see, but what's going on in there? And she says, well, it's hard to explain, but I'm floating through space. And they said, what do you mean you're floating through space? And she says, well, I'm confined to the solar system, but I can move anywhere in the solar system, and that's what I'm always doing, though my body is on Earth. And I think NASA probably said, sure, because they made a test. And they said, okay, if you're really floating through space, then go along this particular satellite we have up there and read a number off of it. It's on the satellite, and we'll believe you. So she did. She read the number off the satellite, and of course, every flag that NASA had went up, and they started using her. And they started having her go to different planets and look around and to all kinds of things. And they began to realize that what she was seeing was just like being there. She was real. At the time that I met her was when those 21 fragments of planet of rock came through, asteroids, and they were the ones that went around the sun and came back and went and slammed into the surface of Jupiter. You guys remember that? That was 96 or something like that. I don't remember when it was. And she was working with NASA at the time. She was going up to each one of those fragments, right up to them, and looking at them and describing them to NASA. So I'm talking to this lady on the phone, and I ended up talking to her for 4 months, and for about once a week for about 2 hours. And it was fascinating. It was absolutely fascinating. I've never met anyone like her. I've met people since then, but this is the first one I've ever met. And after a few times of being with her, she said to me, would you like to see through my eyes? The ones she doesn't have. And of course I said yes. And she said, okay, well then lay down on a bed and make everything dark. So my wife sealed all the blinds off, and it was a new moon, so it was dark out anyway, and turned off all the lights, and I couldn't even see my hand in front of my face. And then she had me prop the telephone up on a pillow so that I could completely relax while I was doing it. And then it took a while. It took maybe 10 minutes of her saying, do you see yet? I'm going, no, I don't see anything. When suddenly, just like a light switch coming on, this phenomena took place. Sitting in front of me, maybe only this far in front of me, was a television screen or a computer monitor, whatever you want to call it, but it was like in that shape. It was about that big. And when you look, but it was really more like a window, because when you look through it, it was just like looking outside, only instead of looking outside, I saw stars. It was just the same stars I see up here, but I could look through and see the stars. And around this television screen were little tiny TV screens that were about 2 inches by 3 inches. And they were mounted all around the outer edge of the screen. And they had images that were moving on them very, very fast. I mean, they were just going flip, 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 flip. About as, you could recognize them, but as they were moving as fast as you could possibly recognize and still see what they were. And she drew my attention to the top right-hand one up here. She says, look at that one. I'm looking at it. And there were images of real pictures of like trees or animals or chairs or things mixed in with geometrical images. They were shuffled together, moving really fast. And she said, that window tells me what's around my body on Earth. So I can look at that and watch television or read a book or walk around or open the refrigerator because I know what's around my body. And she then told me the window on the bottom left side. She only told me two windows out of all these windows. And this one over here, she says, this is how I talk to my brothers and sisters. Well, there were ETs on this thing. And so what she was talking about is other ET races she can communicate through here. And let me make a long story short. Basically, I had a long experience with her. It was about 2 hours long, and I was looking through her eyes, and we went down, we looked at the comets, and we saw all these different things happen. And then after that, she only did this one time, and then after that, we communicated in images and mixed in with geometrical images. That was the whole communication. It was a kind of a strange thing talking to somebody. She'd say, okay, icosahedron and now a tree and things like this. And she'd make me draw them down. And somehow I just knew what she was talking about on really deep levels this way. And then after 4 months, it ended. We both agreed that we were done with whatever we were doing. She left. I've never seen her since. But this phenomena of seeing the center screen with these little screens around it, I've got a lot of very unusual experiences. I don't know how I got them, but I've got them. And I've got this little file I call my weird file. And I put these kind of things away. I don't discount them or anything, but I just wait to see if they'll just connect with something else on some other level, because I couldn't tie what she was doing into anything else that I knew. Several years went by, maybe 3-4 years went by, and I was here in Mexico giving a workshop. I think it was an Earth Sky workshop, which is an advanced level of the Flower of Life. And I was talking about another phenomenon that was going on in China. In 1974, the Chinese government discovered this young Chinese boy. I think he was about 10 or 12 years old. Who could see with his ears. He could see with his ears just as well as you could see with your eyes. They could seal his eyes off. They could duct tape them off. And he could still see perfectly just by turning his ears around and seeing. Well, if it was only one kid, then that would be kind of like Marianne Shenfield. It would just be one person. But they then found another one, and then another one, then another one. And then they started finding ones that could see with different parts of their bodies. One could see with his ears, one could see with the tip of his nose, one could see with his mouth, with the tip of his tongue. Others could see with their armpits. Some could see with their feet or their hands. Some could see with their hair. I think those are all the different parts that they could see with. And so they would choose different ones. And some could see with more than one part. Some could see with two or three different areas of their body at once. sounds outrageous, but this phenomena is not it's absolutely scientifically documented on every level of science within our world. It's now been documented through Nature Journal, which is one of the most prestigious journals in the world, as well as Science News and Omni Magazine and on and on and on, that have, they don't understand it, but they have documented that it's fact and it's true. They've now found 100,000 children that can do this. It's not just two or three. And they're still showing up in mass now, more and more and more. That was about 8 years ago, they were at 100,000. Now it's just climbing right out of off the scale. And nobody's been able to figure out what the heck it means or why they can do that. Omni Magazine was now first, from 1974 until 1984, the Chinese government and the scientific community there discounted it completely and said it was fake. In fact, they even made newspapers dedicated only to the propaganda of letting the Chinese population believe that this was a fake. Until 1984, when they reached 100,000, was in 1984. And then there just became so many of these kids everywhere that were doing it that they finally gave in and realized that it was true. And that's when the rest of the world began to realize it was true. And then they, instead of denying it, they began to make schools to collect them, to begin to study them. And then once they collected them up, they began to find out that these kids could not just see without their eyes. They can do anything they thought of. They could just think of something and just do it, even if it broke all the laws of physics in ways that we can't even understand. They had one kid who was able to put, and this is what, under scientific scrutiny, the scientists would put a table out here, and the kid had to stand across the room, not near it. The scientist would take a bottle of pills that was sealed and put it in the middle. And then they were to put an object off to the side, like a coin or a marble or something. And then this little kid, who's like 6 years old, would come over here and go, "Okay, now." And all the pills would go right through the glass without breaking it and stack up on the table. And then the object would lift up in the air, float over to the bottle, and go right into the sealed bottle, and it's totally sealed. One kid did it, then another, then another, and then another, then 100, then 1,000, and finally 5,000 Chinese kids were able to duplicate that. It's all been documented with science. And then it started to get more and more outrageous. Then this little girl said, "Oh, I can do another one." She was 6 years old. And she made an audience come together of about 1,000 people. And as they walked in, she gave them a rosebud, a tight rosebud. You know, small, tight little rosebud. And they didn't know why they were getting these. And they all sat down. And she came on stage and said, "Okay, hold the rosebud up." And everybody held the rosebud up. And she says, "Okay, now." And all the rosebuds opened up. Can't be a trick. You know, how did she do that? And then it just kept going, and it kept getting more and more outrageous. I mean, to things that these kids began to do things on the same level that Jesus was doing things. Literally. They have scientifically documented two of these children walking right through a solid wall. They're obviously breaking all the laws of physics that we know. But they're doing it, and we can't seem to do anything about it. They're just doing it. Omni Magazine was sent there in late 1984 to check it out, see if it was real. And they were given 100 or so of these kids. These kids are all from about 6 years old to about 14 years old. And Omni said in the article, and you can read everything I'm about to tell you, It was in January 1985 when Omni made this article, so you can just go on the website and get it and read it, that they assumed that the Chinese government was just making a trick or something. And so they made up their own ideas of how they could prove it or test it. And one of the tests was that they took a big stack of Chinese books and they got the children there in a row, in a room. And they just assumed that they had hidden cameras or things like that. So they just pulled a book out at random, flipped open a random page, and before anybody could see it, just ripped it out, crumpled it up, and stuck it under their arm, then walked over to the kids and put it under their arm while it's still in their hand and no one can see it, put their arm down. Every one of these kids could read that page, both sides of it, perfectly. Over and over and over, 100% accurate, not even with a tiny error or once. And they kept making all these kinds of tests, going, well, what is this, you know? I mean, this is not normal psychic ability. This is, usually most psychics are like 60% right or 80% right. They were 100% right every time, whatever they did. So anyway, I was in Mexico giving a workshop here. And I was talking about these kids in China, what was written up about them. And a young lady, 18 years old, a Mexican girl from Mexico City, she goes, oh, I can do that stuff. And I go, you can? She goes, oh yeah, I do it all the time. I've been doing it for years. She says, would you like me to show you? And we go, what am I going to say? Yeah, of course. So she came up, and her name was Inga. She was dressed in all white. She was beautiful. And she came up, and I says, okay, it's all yours. Here's the stage. And so she sat down. She says, okay, first of all, are there anybody in here that's skeptical, that doesn't believe that I can see without my eyes? And everybody sat there. And finally, two young men stood up and said, oh, come on, you can't see without your eyes. And she goes, well, would you two come up here then? And she sat them down and says, here's what I'm going to do. And she took tissue paper and put it in their eyes and then had this long gold scarf and wrapped the scarf around and around and around around their eyes with a tissue paper so nothing would go out until she said, now, can you see? And the guy goes, no, I can't see a thing. Okay. And she did it to the other guy. He says, can you see? And he goes, no, I can't see a thing. She says, okay, do it to me. So they put the tissue paper into the eyes and wrapped this thing around and made sure it was there. She says, are you satisfied that I can't see? She goes, they go, yeah, I don't think you can see. And he says, okay. So they went back and sat down. And she says, and I didn't know what she was going to do. I had no idea. And she says, would somebody give me a photograph? And so a woman just reached in her purse and pulled out a photograph and handed it to her. It was handed to her upside down. She immediately turned it right side up and her finger went like this. And so then she describes the photograph as though she's just looking at it perfectly. It was a couch sitting in a living room with four people on the couch with just a painting behind the couch. And it was not just an ordinary photograph. And so she describes it in detail, the color, the people. There were three females and a male, da-da-da-da, like that. And she says, and I thought that was it. I thought that was... And I started to reach for the photograph, and she said, is there anything you'd like to know about this photograph? And the lady says, well, what do you mean? She says, I can tell you anything. I can tell you who took the photograph, what their name is and their phone number is, and what they were thinking at the time, if you want. I can walk through your house. I can tell you where your house is. I can give you your name and address and phone number. I can tell you all the names of the people on the couch or anything you want. What do you want? She goes, you can? She goes, okay, go to the right of the picture and tell me what's there. And there was nothing there. You couldn't see anything. And she goes, well, you got a hallway right there, and the first door on the left is your bedroom. She went in and described her bedroom in detail, the colors, where the bed was, even went over to her nightstand and told her what was sitting on the nightstand. Then she went out across the door into the next one, which was into her bathroom, and described the bathroom exactly, the colors, the size, the shape, what it was, and everything. And the woman says, "That's enough." She says, "That's absolutely correct." And so she handed her back, and she says, "Is there anybody else has a photograph?" Well, one of these guys jumps up and says, "Come on, you rigged this before. You know this lady. She gave you the thing." He says, "Let me give you something of mine." She goes, "Okay." So he reaches in his wallet and gives his driver's license. But he turns it upside down and backwards when he hands it to her. She immediately turns it right side up and frontwards. And her little finger goes like this. She goes, "It's your driver's license." And she reads off the numbers and addresses and all the stuff on there like that. And he goes, "I don't know how you're doing it, but you're faking this somehow." He says, You are not convincing me. Tell me something that only I know. That only I know. No one else knows." And this little smile comes on her face. She goes, "Okay." And he was there with her girlfriend. She was sitting next to her, but he was standing up here now. And he goes, "You have two girlfriends." and their names are da-da-da-da-da-da, which was one of them that was here. And they don't know about each other. And he starts to go on further. And she's up straight in her chair. And he grabs the license plate out of her, or the thing out of her. And she goes, "That's enough." And walks down and sits down. And she's... and we didn't hear from him ever again. And then other photographs were handed to her by lots of people. Lots and lots of people. And she could go into those photographs and just tell you everything. In fact, there isn't anything that she couldn't tell you. Anything you can think of. She could give you the birth date. She could tell you where you were born. She could even tell you the day you're going to die, down to the minute, and where, and how. She could tell you anything in the future. Tell you anything. As outrageous as it seems, that audience was pretty shocked, I'm sure. Well, later, I brought her to my house. We've become very good friends, and along with her mother, Ema. And for three days, I performed all kinds of experiments. And some experiments that were, you just couldn't fake, not in a million years. I had a whole bunch of bottles of water that we were analyzing, and they were just lettered A, B, C, D, like that. And they all looked the same, except in them were different chemical makeups. Well, she was able to hold the bottle just for a second and tell me exactly what was in the water. Some of those bottles of water, I knew what it was, so she couldn't have been getting it from my mind. But there were about half of them. I had no idea, and some guy in some lab somewhere in the world knew where it was. But she still nailed every single one of them right. And I kept going on all kinds of things, and it didn't matter what I did. She was 100% perfect on everything. And this was fascinating. Then finally, after a couple of days, I was sitting here, and we were doing a break. She was just hanging out on the couch, and I was hanging out on the couch. And we were breaking, we're just talking. And I said, "Inga," I was curious. I said, "What do you see when you close your eyes and you're blindfolded? What do you see inside? What happened? What's going on in there?" And she said, "Oh, it's not important." And I said, "Well, yeah, it is. I'm curious. Just try to tell me what's going on inside there, you know, in your head." And she didn't want to tell me, and I had to keep pushing it. And finally, like about 10 minutes of pushing her, she says, "Well, it's weird, that's why I don't want to tell you. It looks like a little computer screen inside there with these little tiny computer screens around the outside." I almost fell off the couch. That was the last thing in the world I thought she was going to tell me. I mean, here it was, exactly the same as Marianne Shenfield. I said, "I know what that is." She goes, "I know you know what that is." She says, the reason I came to your workshop was because I saw your poster, and when I saw the poster, I knew you were connected to this, and that's why I wanted to connect with you. And I says, oh, okay. So when she left, after she left, then I'm thinking, well, do all the kids in China also see the center screen? So there was a book written about these kids in China called China's Super Psychics. And it was written by a man named Paul Dong. So I found out where he was, and he was in California, and he was 72 years old, and I called him up, really nice guy. We talked for about 2 hours, and it was really, I got lots of good information. But somewhere in that conversation, I said to him, Paul, you've been studying these kids for 15 years or so. What do they see inside their head? And he went through the same thing. He didn't want to tell me. And finally he says, well, I don't really know. I've never experienced it, but a lot of these kids tell us they see some kind of computer screen or television screen inside their head. And I says, they have these little windows around the outside. And he goes, I don't know anything about that. All they say is it's some kind of screen that they see inside their head. And I go, and so now all of my little wheels in my head are going, wow, you know, I know what this is. And it's all tied to darkness. They go in and they seal their eyes off, just like Marianne Shenfield, who was blind. They don't want any light. Not any. They don't want one photon getting in there if they can. They want it completely dark. And this is a huge key in the new consciousness that's unfolding. I found out from her that there were two schools here in Mexico City that teach this, and that she had over 1,000 friends that could do this in Mexico City. Other Mexican kids that were able to see with their hands or their feet or other levels and could know anything about what they're looking at. Then I found out that there were three schools in Russia, and I was able to do research when I was in Russia around all of this, and they've known about it for a long time. They're far more advanced in Russia over Mexico or China. They've got kids there that can do things that these kids have never thought about. That's the whole thing. One kid has to think of something. And then once they think of something, then all the other kids says, oh, I can do that, and they can do the same thing. It's just like they just have to imagine something, and then they're there. The kids in Russia can just pick up a book, hold it for a second, and they got the book, not only on their inner screen, like a computer where they can scroll down and look at it, but they instantaneously know everything that author knows about that subject. They know it all. Whatever he knew, or she knew, they know. And lots and lots and lots. I mean, I'm just touching on some of the subjects of what they've done. The Chinese are even able to change DNA molecules just by looking at them. And they through scientific study, where they're looking at the molecule, and the kids just look at it, and they can actually alter the codons and everything inside that, which implies awesome possibilities of evolution. So at any rate, to make a long story short again, these kids are beginning to pop up everywhere, and it's all tied to an ability to see in darkness rather than in light. With a lot of research and a lot of study, since I know this is true because I had the experience, it's not like I'm guessing. I know, I understand what they're doing. I've been doing a lot of research around this. Recently, I took a group to through the Four Corners area of the United States, doing ceremony with the Anasazi Indians. And when I was in the Navajo Nation, we were going into something called Antelope Canyon. And it belongs to the Navajo Nation, and it's one of the most remarkable places I've ever been in my life. But when we were to get there, the only way they'll do it is they make you get out of the car, and they drive you there. They won't let you go there. And this Navajo shaman, he was maybe 35, 40 years old, and his two grandmothers, who were in their 50s and 60s, well, probably 60s at least, they each drove a truck out to about 20 miles on this dirt road out to where we were. And so we got out there, and I had a group of about 55 people that we were going around with. And he, this man, Darvin was his name, he took us through the canyon to the other side. He got to the other side, he told us stories, he's looking at us and going through this whole thing. He took us back, he sang his peyote songs, did all this thing for us. We got back to the other side, and he's out on the other side, and he's showing us the snake, natural snake pattern on the outside of this, leading into the this canyon. And he's describing all the details in it, and he's telling us, look here and here. And as he's doing that, I'm standing here next to his grandmother, and she goes, it's really amazing, isn't it? I go, what? I mean, he's doing all these things, and he's absolutely blind. He can't see anything. I go, you mean he drove me out here in the truck? And he's blind? He goes, yep. So I got back in the truck with this guy, and he drove me out there. He's completely blind. He's driving down this road like crazy, you know. And he's another one of them. They're all over the place. In Russia, they can train any blind person to do this. They can take a blind person and teach them how to see. It takes about 2 years of training, unless you're under 14, and they can do it in about 2 weeks. But there's a whole other world opening up here. Something extraordinary is occurring in the world. And Jimmy Twyman's finding them in Bulgaria. They're popping up everywhere now. And these are called the super psychic children. These are not the indigo kids. The indigo kids are connected to wherever there are lots of computers. It's a whole another phenomenon that's occurring at the same time while this other one is occurring. And you can almost count the how many computers there are per capita and tell how many indigos are inside of there. And they have another thing happening. They can't do this kind of stuff with their hands and feet and everything. So what's it all about? And what is this special thing that they are bringing to this world? And why are they doing it? Well, this is my opinion, and you may come up to another one. But what I've learned is that there is a place inside of your heart. It was known in ancient times. It's been almost completely forgotten now. But there is a sacred space inside of your heart that if spirit learns how to leave the mind, and I mean absolutely literally go out of the head and travel through the body and go into the heart, and then find this sacred opening and go inside that sacred opening and then find another tiny sacred space inside that heart, that God resides there. God is everywhere, but boy, is God there. And when you enter into that space, you and God become one. And all things are possible. And all knowledge is present there. You can know anything. And you can see out into the outer world from that space. You can connect back to it, even though you are inside of your heart in darkness. You can connect back into this outer world out here and know anything, past, present, or future. What it means, ultimately, I can only tell you what I think it means. Because we're going to all have to live this. We're all going to go through this. We're all going to remember this at one point in this. It's tied to the creation itself. When someone prays to God for something, when they sit down and in all honesty pray, perhaps for their wife or mother or son or daughter to be healed of something, or themselves, or something else. When they go in and they sincerely pray, most of the time nothing happens. zero. But sometimes something does happen. Sometimes a miracle occurs. And people very often don't know why. It just, you have 10 people praying, nothing happens, and one of them, a miracle occurs. Well, the science of miracles was written down, I don't know how long ago it was over 2,500 years ago, however old the Dead Sea Scrolls were. They found another scroll near the Dead Sea Scrolls that Greg Braden has written into a book called The Isaiah Effect, and the exact details of how you create a miracle were done there. You have to include your mind, your heart, and your body all at the same time. If you leave out any one of those pieces, nothing happens. But what Greg has found, we've sat and talked about this for a long time, and we're all coming to the same conclusion, the people that work in this, is that, yeah, you can create miracles from the mind. You can do it. You can do things that are just extraordinary from the mind. Psychic abilities, I've worked with the Monroe Institute. I've worked with the Berkeley Psychic Institute. I've done and seen things that most people would never believe, but I've seen it. But nevertheless, it's still coming from the mind. But the mind has one big problem. The mind is a polarized instrument that is polarized left and right. It's polarized again with the front and back lobes. Everything in it, as it looks out into this one reality, sees everything as polarized. And anything it creates through this mind always creates a polarized reality. And so if you're praying for world peace, you're going to get world peace, but you're also going to get world war. If you're if you're in the mind when you do it, you're going to get the sides of the coin, both the light and the dark of that thing. And you can't help it because the instrument that you're doing it through is polarized. But if you learn how to leave the mind and go into the sacred place in the heart, you can create from there. The heart doesn't know polarization. It only knows oneness and unity. It cares about all levels of life and doesn't see any particular level of life as more important than any other level of creating. It doesn't have any thought patterns or logic in it at all. It uses the dream process. And it uses feelings and emotions. It's feminine rather than masculine. And because it isn't using logic, things don't have to get from A to B logically. Psychic phenomena, you can actually track all psychic phenomena and explain it. The military's been working with that for years, both Russian and Chinese and the United States that I know of for sure. You can track every psychic phenomenon back exactly. You could explain it on how it took place. But you can't explain the creation patterns that happen from the heart. If you do the psychic patterns from the mind, it will appear as a coincidence. But if you do it from the heart, it appears out of nowhere. If you're trying to get an apple in your hand and you're doing it psychically, there's going to be some logical pattern where someone was doing it. I knew all this, and I was trying to experiment with it before I knew about the heart. So I was always trying to manifest an orange. I used to sit for hours. There's an orange in my hand. I could see it. I could feel it. Trying to make this orange happen in my hand. And it never would happen. But I kept believing in it, and I kept trying it because I knew the possibilities of what it was doing. And then one day I was in a meditation group with about 6 or 7 people, and we were all sitting there meditating. And I was meditating for about an hour. And then I said, I'm going to try this orange thing. Nobody knew I was doing it but me. And so I held my little hand out here like that. And I said, there's an orange in my hand. I could feel it. I'm thinking about it. I'm sitting there, and somebody in the room went in the other room, came in there, and dropped an orange in my hand. The impact was incredible. I just went, wow, it's there. And she says, you gave me the orange? There was a logical sequence. I did it. I actually did it. But it was a logical sequence. But if you were in your heart and did that same thing, it would actually appear out of nothing. There doesn't have to be any logic to it. There doesn't have to be any nothing. It just can happen without any science behind it or anything else like that. It's pure feminine creativity. This is where we're going, hopefully, that we can get out of our heads, out of our minds, into our hearts, where our hearts can control our minds rather than our minds controlling our hearts. We don't have any wisdom from our heart, from our minds. We can make incredible science. We can do amazing logical things, but we have no wisdom, and we're killing our planet with this brilliant science that we're doing that's coming from our mind. But we could do the same science and the same things from within our heart. Wouldn't do any harm to anybody anywhere at all. So there is a way, and I can't explain it now, but there is a way where your heart can gain control of the mind. And that's what this workshop that we're about to go into is. I mean, all I can do is give an introduction right now. I can't take you down into that place. It takes 3 days to get there. Sorry, I can't do it. I know. But just with what I'm talking about, you've seen all this logical stuff. You've seen the stuff of the mind. The Merkaba is of the mind also. But the toroidal fields, I'll just tell you the secret, the toroidal fields of the Merkaba, of the mind, and the toroidal fields of the heart. Yes, the heart has toroidal fields. Stanford University has scientifically proven this. They found that the most powerful electromagnetic field that's emitted from the human body does not come from the mind, but comes from the heart. And it's big. It's an electromagnetic field that extends 8 to 10 feet out from around the body, and it's in the shape of a torus. Again, that donut shape. And the axis runs down right through the heart, and it, which happens to run exactly through the sacred space, because that's the generator of it. And so you have the axis of the Merkaba right over here. At one point in the development, the axis of the heart and the axis of the Merkaba link, and the Merkaba field synchronize, and this phenomena takes place, which is the next level. It's the second level of the Merkaba. And this is where, this is what we're in the process of learning how to remember what this is about. Finally, there will be a third level that's coming, that it may not be me, it might be you, it might be someone in the world that will understand it. But once the heart links with the mind and gains control of the mind, then the sexual energy of the body takes on a whole new purpose and meaning. What's associated with creativity, the creation? How is a new human being born? It's through conception, and it's through sexual energy that takes place. When sexual energy is used in a very pure way, used through the heart patterns and through the mind of the Merkaba, true creation can actually take place. Anything's possible at that point. And this is where we're leading to. And this is how we're going to get out of these problems that we've got, that we have created in our mind. I wish I could go deeper into all of this, but I really can't without a lot more training that I could take you through. But it's all I can do right now. Now there is one thing, and I've been asked to do this. One of the problems of people being able to get into the heart, no matter how much study you do or how much work you do, what I've discovered is that some people can't get in there because they have emotional trauma in their heart. They've been rejected by a mate, or they've had a divorce, or something's happened that has hurt so bad that they've sealed it. And when they go into their heart, they feel that pain, and they go back out and they go, I can't go in there, it hurts. And so in many different shades of that same experience, for one reason or another, they can't get in there. And the only way that they can we can get them in there is through healing the emotional heart of their heart space. And so we've developed a system in the school to do that, but it's not real good. Ideally, you actually have therapy. You go through therapy to solve the emotional problems before you begin to do this heart work. This would be the most perfect thing to do. And there are many really good people out there in the world. We're very fortunate now because they're all over. The science has been developed very high. My wife is also involved in this, and she has a system that's 4,000 years old that came from the original people who first wrote about the Merkaba. She's trained as a psychologist from Harvard and all this stuff, but she just threw that out. She says that was useless for what she learned, and studied from the people who had learned this. They were all a 96-year-old lady in Jerusalem that held this pattern. And so there is ways we're using images that are inside the body to solve these problems completely so that you can go into the heart just like that. And so if this is something that you think you may be involved in, or any, really, truly, any other aspect of spiritual work, no matter what it is or what level it is that you're working in, the emotional body must be healed first. They knew this in Egypt, and they knew it in Greece. They knew it all over. My wife will be here, when is it, in September? September 7th. Okay, so approximately that time. And if you're interested in her helping you in that way, Conchita can help you. You can find other ways. That's not the only, my wife's not the only way. There's lots of others that can help you. But without that emotional balance, you can't do this properly. It won't work. So this is what the work is. This is what the flower of life is involved in, these three levels. The first one is the Merkaba. The second one has to do with the heart and the heart spaces and what's involved in that. And finally, the work with the sexual energy and how to work with all of that. And though the sexual programs will probably not be out there for at least a year or two. So, that's it. Now, if there's any questions, I'll do what I can to answer them. If you have a question, if you could come up here to this microphone and ask the question, I'll do it. If you feel to go now, you can. It's up to you. You don't have to do this. But if you want to watch, or if there's something else that you want to follow through there, I'll stay here until for another half hour or so.
Sí, vamos a dedicar algún momento para preguntas. Las personas que deseen hacer preguntas, si se acercan aquí y hacen una fila, por favor, y les vamos dando el micrófono. Vamos a dedicar un poco de tiempo, no demasiado, porque no podemos estarnos toda la noche, pero lo que podamos. Es que nos emocionamos y luego aquí no nos vamos nunca. Si alguien quiere acercarse.
Yo quería saber un poco de los niños índigos.
The indigo children are, okay, if you look at the mind, it's divided into the left and the right side. The left side is male and logical, the right side is female and emotional. The planet, Earth, is divided in the same way. It's not a straight line, but there are areas of the Earth that are associated with the left brain and areas that are associated with the right brain. Like India and Tibet are in the right brain, and the United States and Germany are definitely in the left brain. What's the psychic children that have been talking about that can see with their hands and feet fall into the right brain. The indigo children fall into the left brain of the planet, and they are logical and very intelligent. Their IQ is very high. Somewhere in the 130s, 136 or so is approximately in there. That used to be one child in 10,000, and now it's becoming normal. These kids usually, though, don't have a broad spectrum genius. They usually have spikes or certain areas. That, in other words, they're only a genius in the areas they like, things that they want to do. And in the areas that they like and they want to do, they're incredible. You can hardly measure their intelligence in those areas. And they are slightly psychic. They know what you're thinking and feeling, but that's pretty much the extent of it, at least what I've been able to see. So if you're a parent of them and you're trying to raise them using the old guidelines, you know, it doesn't work. It absolutely, you just end up in a mess because they know what you're thinking. And so if you lie to them, they know you're lying. And if you lie to them very much, they won't listen to you anymore. And so you can't say no to them either. You have to explain to them and talk to them as though they're an adult because they're really intelligent, even though they're just little kids. The United States is trying to figure out what to do right now. Lee Carroll's book, The Indigo Kids, which was written, that was not written by Lee Carroll or Jan Tabor. It was a summation of the works of many psychologists and doctors and people who were in the testing of these children. And it's very clear that there is a phenomenon going on in the world that we don't quite understand, besides the one with the super psychic kids. And it's changing everything. Where you're going to find these kids is where there's computers. The highest computer ratio in the world is in Israel, and that's where you're going to find the highest ratio. But the United States is very high in them also. And by 1984, they began to see them coming in mass. And by the time he wrote his book, which I don't remember when it was 1997 or so, where 80 to 90% of all the children being born in the United States were indigo kids. At this point today, it's near, if not at, 100%. Every single kid, just about. But that's because the United States is such a left-brain country. Mexico's kind of got both going on. You've got some indigos and some super psychics going on. You've got both things happening at once. And so you can't just say, well, I got an indigo kid. I mean, you've got to really kind of look at it and see what's going on there because you don't know. How did Inga's mother know that she had a super psychic kid? It was real obvious. She told me herself. She said when Inga was 6 months old, she was laying in her crib and asleep, and she heard some noises, and she walked into the room, and this little baby had taken all of her toys that were around the room, and they were floating over her bed, and she was sitting there playing with them as they were floating in the air. She knew for sure. And so, but the indigo kids are harder to see because they look more normal. And but these kids are from what all the people who are studying these kids, and especially the psychics who are studying them, they're not from Earth. We are infusing very high levels of awareness from other places, certain regions of space and time and dimension, that have agreed to come into Earth at this time to raise our consciousness, because if somebody doesn't do this, we're not going to make it, because we don't have enough consciousness to be able. We've got some things coming in the future very soon that are big, really big, and we have to be able to be on another level to be able to deal with these things. And that's what they're doing, is they're coming here to help us. And so I could go on for another hour probably, but that's the essence of what the indigo kids are.
You know, maybe I missed it, but before we went out for the break, you mentioned you were going to tell us when we came back about the message.
The message?
Yes. You mentioned about a message that the other civilization was trying to transmit to us.
Did that go through the translation? Oh, the plasma ships.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Well, their message is, as I understand it from them, is exactly what I'm talking about. The thing that we need to know about ourselves is about our heart, and that if we know that we can go in there, we can change the outer world. All the polluted oceans, the ozone, the problems, the stuff, all the things that are, that look hopelessly like you can't fix them, well, you can. And more, if we learn to change from our mind to our heart and get inside of there. And eventually this leads into a place where you become pure light. And whatever you think happens, whatever you feel, whatever you dream actually happens. The message, though, will have to be delivered by them and exactly how they want it. But I know that it is in this area of what this message is. I can't tell you exactly what they're going to say. But it is in that area what they want to say to us. That's about all I can say on that. Okay.
I read in your website many years ago about the water of life or something like that. What's about that water now? It's healing the earth?
Well, we've been studying water for, 12, 14 years. Water is way more than you know. There is potential in water that is... all of our energy problems could be over with water in ways that we can't even imagine right now. What we're finding is incredible. But along that line of testing, we came across a water that came out of Turkey. And that water held the potential of healing all the rivers and lakes and everything of the environment. It was a very unusual water. We studied this at SAIC, which is a government thing in Washington, D.C., they showed how you can just take this water and just put you can take a lamp and just stick a plug in it. It'll light up the lamp brighter than if you plugged it in the wall. And you could take polluted water and put a little bit in there and just watch it go clear. It was amazing potential. But the people that were behind it were not very nice and hidden agendas and had stolen the formula and weren't telling the truth, and we had to drop it. Fortunately, something even better has just come along. And we're speaking, which is very similar to that water, and we're speaking with the Mexican government right now to see if we can introduce this into the water system of Mexico. It is the most unusual substance that chemistry has ever seen. Texas A&M University, who is analyzing this right now, we were just talking to them, said they have never seen anything like it. They didn't even know it could possibly exist. We have learned how to nanoize minerals, and it's water with 72. It's a substance, deuterium, with heavy water, with 72 minerals, 18 amino acids, and pure liquid oxygen. But they've been nanoized, meaning that the minerals are 100,000 times smaller than an angstrom. And they're so small that they pass right through cells and nourish cells and give it everything it needs. And so you can do things with it. They're healing AIDS, they're healing cancer, they're doing everything with this. They believe they can heal any virus in the world, actually, right now with this. And SARS can be healed with this, too. We believe it. AIDS has been demonstrated by universities, and so has cancer. SARS, there should be no reason why SARS, because it's just another polyhedron. This water, we hope, will be introduced into Mexico because it is the best water purifier the world has ever seen. Right now, you're using chlorine, which is a deadly poison. And it's really a bad thing to put in water. And it doesn't last long. If you take chlorine out of the water goes dirty very soon. You can take a fish tank with 20 gallons in it and put 6 drops of this in there, and the water will stay absolutely clean and pure for 6 to 9 months. And so, but the thing about this is it's a water purifier. It's totally non-toxic. But the reservoirs and lakes and rivers that have this, anything that's in those lakes, the fish, the bacteria and everything, it will cure it. It'll make it healthy. The birds that drink from it will get healthy. The trees will get healthy. We have a group in Texas, a bunch of cowboys, who said, well, I'm going to make a business out of this, these guys. And so they're going and buying the old cows that have cancer in their body and their skin and bones. And they can buy these for 12 cents a pound because nobody wants them. They can't sell them. And they're taking these old beat-up cows and bringing them back and feeding them this water. and all their cancer is going away, and they're getting fat and healthy and selling them and making money, and they think it's a great thing. But this water holds a huge potential, and my feeling is that I'm hoping that Mexico will be able to do the testing and see what it is and introduce it into the water system. It's a good thing. It's a really good thing. Turkish water, unfortunately, you're never going to see it happen because they could only make little tiny quantities of it. Okay.
¿Alguno de los niños psíquicos que pudieron ver el futuro dijeron algo acerca del futuro de la humanidad?
What psychic children?
De los niños super psíquicos que comentó que podían ver el futuro.
You said that the super psychic can see the future, so if they say something about the future?
Well, here's what I know and what I believe, combination of both, with these super psychic children. First of all, Inga and other ones that I've talked to are having a really hard time. Because, like when Inga was going through high school and dating, for example, she'd date a guy, but she knew everything he was thinking. And she realized the guy didn't really like her. All he wanted was her body. And she knew everything that was going on, and so she ended up isolating herself in a room and just sitting there and didn't want to go out and see people because she could look at everyone and knew everything, and she says, basically, everyone's crazy and didn't want to deal with it. Well, they're all having that kind of problem. And at the same time, the Indigo kids are seeing this also on another level. These kids in like in the United States and other places that are running around with machine guns and killing all the kids in schools, those are Indigo kids because they're just so angry that they're in this world that is so messed up. It's okay. They're going to go through all this stuff, but they're slowly going to begin to link. And I knew this from 1971. The angels talked about them for a long time, told me that they were coming, told me that they would begin to come in 1972. Science has only been able to document it back to 1974, but I know they started actually in 1972, and said that eventually what would happen is a day would come when all these children, both the indigos and the super psychics, both the left and the right side of the brain of the world, stretching across all the countries of the world, would link and become a single living being. Just as you are 10 trillion cells in your body, they have all linked together and become you and have one will, one thought, and one path. And when all these children do this, if they do it, there are people who believe that they're watching it starting to take place today, it's starting to happen this year, actually, if all those kids were to link together, they would be stronger than any religion, any government, anything. They would just take over the planet, and whatever they said happened would happen. And what did Jesus say about this? Jesus was really clear about this particular time. He said that it would be the children who would lead the way. They would be the ones that would take us into the higher levels of consciousness. And that's exactly what happened. He also, or I believe that's what's going to happen. He also said another thing. He said that in terms of the second coming, of his second coming, that he would come in the hearts of the multitude. In the hearts of the multitude. As the people, that's where the Christ, the second coming, emerges. So between that understanding and the children, you're going to see a phenomena happening over the earth over the next 10 years that is... The earth is going to change. We're going to be a different place completely. So that's what I feel about the children.
Hello. Yo quiero, lo puedo decir en español, ¿verdad? Lo puedo decir en español y lo traduce. Okay. Lo dije yo en México. Tengo a lo mejor más o menos como 3 años que estoy recibiendo mensajes y yo no tengo mucho contacto con las computadoras. apenas estoy aprendiendo, pero alguien da mi dirección y llegan mensajes con el corazón, con el Sagrado Corazón de Jesús, y me dedico a dar conferencias, y efectivamente empecé yo a introducir metáforas del maestro, y se me aparece por todos lados, a todas horas, y me quedo impresionado que en tu libro viene la segunda venida, y lo estoy leyendo por todos lados, y quiero creerlo, quiero creer que es la promesa.
You want to believe in the second coming of Jesus? Well, I believe in it. I believe it will occur, but I don't believe it's going to happen in the way that most Christians believe it's going to happen. It isn't Him coming here, though He may, but it's all of us becoming like Him, becoming the Christ at once. That's the second coming. Okay. Any more? Okay. One more question, and I think we're going to end. Okay.
Bueno, yo quiero preguntar porque fue una coincidencia para venir aquí a la conferencia. Compré un libro de la Cábala en donde menciona la Merkaba como carroza divina. Entonces, yo quería preguntar si es la misma que nosotros formamos, o sea, y habla del trono, para encontrar el trono de Dios.
Yeah, they're one and the same. The Kabbalah, and also in the Torah, describe the vehicle of light, the Merkaba, equally, and they are one and the same. It's the same thing. Okay, everybody. Thank you. I hope this was helpful for you. And I love you guys. Okay. Bye-bye.